Welcome to the little scene upstairs, storage slash junk room of my workshop. For years now, it's been annoying me that this blank has been up here. This is a blank for Cerberus, one of the swords I made for the TV show Big Giant Swords. So the reason this blank is up here is because when you're doing a TV show or similar about making stuff, they'll often be like half-made things for the guys to film, and then the actual finished one will have been finished weeks and weeks previous. So this blank has been sitting up here uselessly, and I've always been tempted to finish it off, to make it into a second Cerberus, because it's just wasteful having it hanging up here. But I thought, like, oh, it's kind of too much work for something that nobody has, like, lined up to buy or shown an interest in buying. But then I found this guy, which is a finished blank for one of the sub swords, one of the little swords that mounts onto Cerberus to make like a, you know, because it's a Cerberus, it was three swords that click together. And I was like, that it's so close to finished. Like, now that's two pieces of steel that are going to waste. So I said, screw it, that's what I'm going to do in this video. I'm going to finish off Cerberus, or this Cerberus, and make a second version of the one from the TV show. And even if no one buys it or nothing, I can still just have it like hanging around as an example of a finished sword. It's too long for this board. I'm going to have to set up something 6 foot. I'd forgotten that the writ from Hollywood was that all the swords had to be 6 foot. That was like the minimum size for a giant sword. I tried explaining to them that, like, you know, this sword would have been probably just as crazy at 3/4 of the size and somewhat usable, but nah, they wanted everything to be 6 foot. I think it was because one of the first swords I made was Sarah Robles' sword, and they were concerned that that one wasn't big enough because they know nothing about swords. So this offcut, strangely enough, is from doing the Zeus blade from the TV show as well. It's always been like a little bit of an awkward shape, and I don't make many swords that are this size. So it's kind of handy in this instance. It's been in the corner of my workshop the same length of time, a couple of years. It's nice that I finally get to use it to do something. There we go. Even that's still not enough. I don't know how pH works. If I fill this up with water, it's got the same amount of vinegar in it, but it makes it less acidic, so it'll take longer. I don't know, I'm gonna have to water it out. And this is all submerged this side. I just need to see that tip over there disappear. And it's got... The vinegar is severely watered down, but there's the same amount of vinegar as there would have been. There's three things of vinegar, which I know is enough vinegar. How does the watering it down compare to using stronger stuff but a less amount of it? Surely it's the same? I don't know. Some sciencey person can talk about that. Like, which will etch a thing faster, 20 milliliters of some acid at 3%, or 10 millimeters at 6%. Surely they're the same, right? Who knows?
Now you can see the outlines of them in the bubbles. There's my shadow ruining the shot.
But yeah, that should be ready to come out now.
Look at all the crazy stripes.
I don't know, is that caused by something in the hardox? Or is it just all the ebbing and the flowing in the poison pool? Like, does it like, you know, as the currents drip across it with the wind, does it do something odd? That stripe looks suspicious. I think it's something in the hardox. Like, almost like the way you bring out the stripes in the Damascus.
Hardox does have different layers of hardness in it, but I haven't been able to bring them out.
I tried the ferric chloride stuff on it once, and it doesn't really work.
Oh, I think this is the one that was really rusty. I wonder, does hardox have a surface layer that the rust disrupts?
Maybe to bring the stripes out, you have to leave it outside under a pile of garbage to rust for a couple of months. Thing about doing all these teeth is it's very awkward shapes. See the way it grabs the disc, tore the disc on me. I think my face is okay. I felt something. I didn't feel something hit me. I thought something flew by my face, but yeah, I think I got away with it. I was wearing my goggles, but still. So that's one side sharpened. I might do, this was only the medium interleaf flap disc. Yes, so this was but I might hit it with the finer interleaf flap disc afterwards.
So this area on Cerberus gets wrapped in chains. I just want to see, did I actually buy enough? Because it always takes a shocking amount of anything to wrap something. Okay, I think we're good. We'll deal with it. What I'll do is I'll TIG weld it along the edge. Get it to stay. That's the other thing, is like when you have a thing that's looks cool because it's wrapped in chain. You know, in real life the chain would just fall off a lot of the time, depending on how it's wrapped. You know, I'm talking about like swords and art. You know, to get up some character with chains around his wrists or something. And it's like, how is that staying there? Because with the weight, they'd all just slump to the end or whatever. But the other thing to deal with is, this is zinced. I dealt with this a lot when I was in art college. People who would buy chain for their whatever projects. And, you know, it would look like new shiny chain. And if you actually want chain for something useful, the fact that it's zinced and doesn't rust is great. But if you're an artisty type person and you want a slightly older looking chain for whatever, or you don't want people to be distracted by the fact that it's zinced, it's not so good. And I found the best way to get rid of zinc off a chain is to just burn it off.
I have to double check, but I'm pretty sure that's done. There's parts of it that look white, and I'm not sure do they look white. Is there anything on it that still looks shiny? Like, I'm pretty sure all of the stuff is gone. Can't touch it at the moment because it's very hot, obviously. But it was that was actually a lot of material, and this thing's very kind of wimpy, so it was hard to get all of it up to like an even red. So I'm doing this on the basis that I've burned off most of the zinc already, so it's not disastrous to throw it in the fire and maybe catch that last little bit. In an open fire, you might give yourself zinc poisoning. I'm also banking in any remaining zinc fumes to be carried up the chimney and away. But you can see that even a regular wood stove is hot enough to make a little thin chain glow. This is what the chain looks like after the fire. I might put it in vinegar too. There's still some bits where there's like yellowy stuff left on the surface. It kind of rubs off with your finger, but not really. But hopefully it's damaged enough now that I can leave it in vinegar and it'll just take the rest off. Hopefully darken it up a bit too. That would be great. The whole point is, like, the zinc look is too shiny for the look I'm going for. And also, the zinc itself makes the chain difficult to weld. So this will solve, stripping the zinc off will solve two things. Hello, goats. Where'd you guys come from? I'm not sure is it a great idea for the goats to be in here. These are neighbor goats, not my goats. That was having a drink. Okay, guys, get out of my workshop. Go, go, go. This must have been treated with creosote or something. All this oily stuff started spewing out of it when I was trying to make this form. The reason I'm making this form is I've decided I want to curve these plates and put more of a roundiness on the handle pieces before I sandwich them on. Originally I wasn't planning on doing that at all, but I was thinking that it looked, even at half inch, it was a little bit flat for such a big sword. So now by just whapping along the edge, it's flat enough to weld down. Hopefully I'm going to still have to trim the edge, because that was the plan, is that these were cut up a little bit too big. Trim the edge, match it to the handle more, and then weld it on. Hopefully that works. My guess was nearly right. These ones on the other side will just indicate that I haven't gone crazy with lining these things up.
So I need some sort of mark that will survive the massive amount of heat. These are really kind of crappy looking because they're so shallow. The shallower the mark, the harder it is to control the flow of the thing. So, hopefully that won't matter because I've been building these up and then grinding. But that's what's going on here. I'm going to have to go all around and do that all the way around. Might do that with the C-wire brush instead of my finger.
The such as an anti-spatter, just to stop the blade from getting completely aesthetically messed up. Yeah, I'm going to use maybe even a little C-wire brush to get the soot out of the actual groove. And I'm going to use the MIG welder because the MIG welder delivers a lot of material quickly, but it's very messy. So hopefully the soot can keep it halfway respectable. So what I've done here is I've turned the welder down to a level where it's still sticking to the surface properly. Actually, a welder would have to be turned down very low before like the bead wasn't even sticking to the surface. But this is turned down too low if you were actually wanting to join one piece to another piece. So this is like, it's making a very high bead, which is normally a sign of a garbage weld that won't join properly. But and that's like a problem actually when a lot of people in videos complain about welds that they've interacted with like breaking. It's usually just, well, I mean I'm not sure, but I think what's happening is a lot of people are welding stuff with underpowered welders and they're getting beads like these, and they're breaking because there wasn't a lot of penetration into the surface, which is actually what I'm aiming for here, because I'm not after penetration into the surface. I'm after this very high stuff where I can start to build up a shape without it going, because there remains of a much flatter one here, and that was like, and then there's another one over here that was a little bit higher, and then I was trying to get it as high and lumpy as possible but sticking to the surface properly, because that'll be the best thing for building up these the edges of these tooth socket things. Now if memory serves, the frame rate on the camera tends to do something odd when you're trying to film the MIG welding. So let's try it and see what happens. So that's the idea. The frame rate did go all crazy. I try to focus on this stuff. Come on. There we go. So you can see how it's very high at the front. And then there's ones at the back that I'll be able to grind into a slope down onto the surface of the blade. To reiterate, in case it wasn't clear, these aren't great welds. If you were welding for joinery, you'd have the welder turned up higher. These are just for the purposes of adding material to the surface. I should not have taken off my mask. It is fairly rank in here, but that's one of four sides done. Does this soot actually work as an anti-spatter? Whoa, everything is way too hot to touch. Steel wire brush. Things that look like spatter. So that one's stuck on, but that was right beside the weld zone. Meanwhile, back here, are any of these guys stuck on? No, none of those little bits are stuck on. So, yeah, I think it worked in terms of, like, it does work half an inch away from the blast zone, but it works all the way over here. What about these areas? These will be annoying if it didn't work. Yeah, it worked in here too. Because this area would affect with me clamping it and reclamping it and stuff. Whew! That's one side done. You can see it's bent like a banana. Now, the hope is, when I do the other side, that it'll bend the in the corresponding direction. See, what does the other side look like? Okay, this was the other thing. This weld is messing up the temper, but can you see how the blue, the heat distortion zone, doesn't extend all the way out to the teeth? The tip of the teeth? You know, like you have these hardened tips, and then the rest of it probably has the same temper as like regular steel. It's like a McQuittle or whatever, except instead of being wood and obsidian, it's regular steel and hardened steel. Whew! Now to do this side. So that's the last of the welding done. Let's see what happens when I unclip. Actually, I'll unclip the ones at the top. Boop. That tooth stayed flat. That's a good sign. Could it be that it didn't have enough heat to bend it in the opposite direction? That's always a possibility. What happens if I undo this one? Okay, so there's still a weirdness here. More stuff to do there, so I'm not so worried. We have to do this guy. Oh, that's not so bad though. Like, that was bent like a banana when I started. Can I touch this guy? It's kind of hot. The earth gets, the ground earth, whatever you guys call it, gets very hot when you're doing this much welding. Yeah, so it's definitely bent, but it's nowhere near as bad as it was. When I was putting that guy on, this top bar, I had to fight with it to get it flat. And now it more or less is flat.
My face. My face. My face. My face again, and the thing is tight.
This thing might only need a very gentle amount of sledgehammer encouragement to go back to being straight. Looks straight till you get down to the handle. Why would the handle be bent? Did the handle start off bent? Was the handle bent as a byproduct of cutting out this blank a billion years ago? Oh man,
yeah, so I think it's just the handle
that's bent. And that might have been a byproduct of burning out the blank a billion years ago.
So what I'm trying to work out here is what lint to make. And the peg that'll go through here for holding on left head and right head when they're locked onto the center head. And so just working out the distance it has to be given the half inch spacer on the bottom, the quarter inch blade, half inch spacer, quarter inch other subsword hanging off it, the rounded bit at the end, like what size it would need to be to adequately hold on the blades. Oh yeah, and the extra half inch for the peg, the lock, shlink, to lock through. And then a bit of a roundiness on the end. 3 inches was the answer. That's still hot, which is good because it's cold today. It's warming my hands.
I was sent a groovy optical punch. This would be like the perfect opportunity to use it if it can fit on the, if it can actually fit on here. Let's see, can I find the optical punch and can it fit on here? This drill bit is blunt, it's pushing, see what, you can see better if I hold this still, see it pushing the body of the drill is getting pushed up. I might try to sharpen that one. Okay, that's halfway. I'm gonna flip it and then go in from the other side. And that we limit the damage of whatever wandering this is done. Drill through with this big long guy and then go through with the half inch that I actually want to go through. Yep. So, complained a little bit. I wonder how much the half inch one will complain. How am I going to set this up? Because I don't have a big, huge, that's a airplane bit. Or something like that, a crazy long drill bit. I wonder if I use my lathe chuck, will I be able to get this up higher so that the half inch one can go through? That's the hole through, but you can't see it, it's too dark, and this guy is kind of too hot to be holding, but let's see. Can we get the owl there? There you go. And you can see the hole is all wonky and off center. But it shouldn't matter too much because that's where the... it's a little bit better on this side. But drilling a half inch hole through 3 inches of 1 inch, I guess, was too optimistic. But it's only for the spring. So nobody will see that if I put some sort of cap either end, which I plan to do anyway. So I'm not so worried about it. It's more a personal pride thing that I wasn't able to do that as neatly as I had hoped. Yeah, the heat is even coming through this welding glove. Now, the moment of truth. is the distance between these two points. The vernier is out of batteries. The router is stuck in the square. 1.75 inches. Good enough.
Oh man, that was a nightmare, especially this one. I might have to use a die grinder. I was going to do a die grinder to make a bevel around them anyway, so it was easier to slide the thing in. But hopefully I might be able to have to use that to disguise how off-center. Yeah, I just did not want to go half-inch hole through this 1 inch on the curved surface. Working my way up through the sizes, it still wanted to skitter off the side. I thought it was weird. It didn't want to skitter in towards this guy, but always... Both of them wanted to skitter off this side. And I don't quite understand why. I mean, because obviously that's better for the drill. But it had no way to know that this was better for the drill. So I don't know why both of them pushed out this way. So they're both relatively acceptable on the bottom. But where it was going in on the top, you can see this one skittered off this way. I might have to... This one's not too bad. Although, you know, like if I put a die grind side to side... To make it look a bit better than that, because that's kind of messy. Look, you can see the line. Look how much it wandered off the line. It would... Gross. Gross. I'm kind of making this up as I go along. I want to make a cap on here. Seal off this end. And then round off both ends, but have this threaded piece here so that I can make a little grub screw thing that goes, that screws in. And that'll be for access to the spring, so that if something wonky happens with the spring, that'll be in here between these two points, that you can take a grub screw off and do something creative with a pliers and lots of swearing. There we go. Whew. And that's a small amount of threads, but it's enough for my purposes. There's going to be a ridge here for the left head, right head to rest on, and then a pin goes through that locks it into position. And I just have to make sure that there's clearance on both sides for these half inch pins to go through without rubbing off the half inch bit that's supporting it underneath.
So that's what we're at here.
My grinder stopped working, and so I isolated it down to the switch for controlling the speed was the broken thing. So I bypassed the switch for controlling the speed. So we're going to see now, does it work or does the whole thing blow up? Okay, I can order a new one of these online and use it as just a normal angle grinder until that arrives. This switch lasted for years, plural, so I don't think it's like the idea of having an adjustable speed is bad. And in fact, I use the adjustable speed a lot, so I'm somewhat invested in replacing it. Pretty okay though. I was careful about clamping it because I knew this would become an issue. I think it's good to weld as is. Too hot. There we go. God damn, the chuck of that drill is garbage. Although I have been doing nonsense stuff with it for over a year. Imagine if I broke this drill bit now. How funny would that be? There we go. Now, is there an actual hole down there? There is. I think it's stuck on the far side. I think it gets stuck on the far side. How funny would it be if this tap broke? Because I'm trying to do a thing at such a weirdo angle. It seems to be tapping okay. The hand drilled holes are always a little bit looser because the unavoidable vibration shaking around of your hand. It's bad for the drill bits too. It seems like it's going okay. I'm either tearing all of the teeth off the tap or this process is going okay. I'm not sure which. Sometimes it gets tight, and those are the crisis points when you might push too hard, snap the tap in two, and then have all the fun and games of getting it out of the hole. Oh, I think we're through. Are we through? We're through! Whew! Holy moly. When the spring's in there, it'll be okay, but at the moment I'm not sure how deep to go. I guess I can just keep going till it falls out the other side, because it's the other side that has the access hole. There he goes, fell out. I might have to put tread lock or something on it to keep it at the right. Maybe even a piece of nylon tape, something that makes it so that it doesn't rattle around, but that it's easy enough to reverse if you need to. Sure, I just heard something. I'm not sure what. Where's the flashlight gone? Stewie, what are you doing here? This is not a good place for cats. I haven't seen you in ages.
This is neighbor's cat. But you can't come in. No, this workshop is not for cats. You're so skinny. You're like cat-shaped. My guy is more chunk-shaped. So now,
I'm going to be making the pins. I've made this guy already slightly different to the way I did it originally. It didn't have all the hollowness and for the spring and all that business. Because the way I did it last time for the TV show in a rush, it was just I was hoping that friction would just hold them in, but they kind of, they never actually fell out while I was using the sword or heaving the sword around, but I was always afraid that, like, in the course of using the sword, these things would fly out. So the whole point of this spring business is we're going to create a version of the pin where you have to, like, force it in and force it out, and there's enough tension provided that it can hold this pin in place even if the whole thing is upside down, that there's no possibility of it sliding. So that's what these marks are, taper, and then this thing gets concaved, and then this part gets flattened for the chain to be attached. To widen this part at the back. So I put the spring in there just to see does it fit and stuff, and I wanted to show, get a shot of me putting the spring in and stuff, but I can't because it won't come out. Can I film it this way? Hang on. You can see the spring in there, and it's actually a different spring. Where's my bag of springs gone? See, I got a whole bunch of different springs that were a half inch in diameter, with all different levels of wire gauge, and it turned out the one that worked was actually way thinner than the one from the previous shot, but it won't come out now, it's stuck in the hole. Like, I don't even think the set screw thing would have been necessary, but I might also clean up this head now that the thing is finished and it's working. Just the aesthetics of this thing are annoying me slightly. Might do something a bit different than this, but now let's just test this guy a little bit. Now, the problem with the previous version of this I built, I mean, it wasn't a major problem, but still it annoyed me, was the because the way the pins were, they worked fine when the sword was upright, when you were holding it, you know, like this. But when the sword was upside down like this, the pins sometimes had a tendency to fall out. That's the whole point of this gadget here, is to make it so that they go in and stay in. And it's like, do they actually stay in?
So, that stayed there. It didn't move. So, I'd say that's good enough. So the idea is these guys have a piece of chain connecting them to the end of the sub swords, sword handles. So that's what the holes are for. Okay, so the idea with this is I didn't really like the rough screwdriver head I did, especially because when tight, it didn't, whatever way this went in there, it didn't actually line up. So instead, I put this guy on top, which was instead of screwdriver-y, is designed to be like grabbed with a pliers, and it's a more interesting shape. It's crude now, but I'm gonna clean this up. There we go. I think that guy's a little bit just tidier looking than that X. And then if you need to undo it, you can, you know, just grab it with a thing. Although you'd want to be careful not to damage it, I guess. Although you could always, like, damage the X, I guess, by the screwdriver hopping out of the shallow hand-made grooves as well. Actually, I might undo this and then give this guy a bit more of a polish with this guy not here. I can get the front half of those little bits.
So what we're doing here is there's two ridges on the sword that hold the sub swords in place, stops them drifting this way and that way when they're locked down with the pin. And so we're bending those ridges now. That's the shape that have to be chalked on. We're going to use this peg and this thing here. You could bend this stuff cold with enough force, but it's cold today. It's an excuse to use this thing. Okay, just to do that for two. I wonder if I bend this one big long one, would I be able to get both out of it? Probably. How much of a cheapskate do I want to be? I kind of want to be a cheapskate. I'll try to get both of them out of this. Bend this one a little bit more. I'm getting a memory that I'd completely forgotten up to this point. This isn't great, but I didn't want to clamp here because it was giving me a false. These guys can actually slide over this surface, but I remember now on the original, this memory might be one I'm inventing right now, but I'm pretty sure I put these pegs on here with these little extra bits of material that stopped, like if it came out this way, stopped it being able to turn this way, because to make it easy to take off, you want to leave some space. It needs little things on here once I actually attach it. So, it's funny, I'd completely forgotten about that until I encountered the exact same problem. I must have gone through all of this pretty much the exact same way when I was making the original one.
and then just completely deleted that section of the process in my head.
The thing I want to be careful of is that both of these guys can actually fit on here relatively easily, because I'm sure this, because all of this was like shaped to be organic. You wouldn't want a side where only one of them fits on. So it's actually lower than the line as drawn, possibly because the blades are a little bit bigger than the templates. Matches here and here, and then it kind of weirdly dips lower in here, but it looks fine. So we're going to tack it at this position, then figure out the one on the back. Try and lock them on now and stand the sword up, which won't quite work without those little peg things, but before I get welding, before I move to the next step, I want to make sure this actually looks right. I remember last time I met the sword, it bit me something awful. It was standing, leaning up against the wall, and it slid, and I put up my hand to catch it. It bit me through the hand, but we were filming stuff, and I knew the Hollywood guys, the showrunner and stuff, would go insane if they'd seen I had this wound, so I hid it from them. But it can be an awkward sword to handle. See, is the swords, do they make an even X, or do they look funny? Braced on. So that looks like the angles are even, you know, that that's making an actual even-ish shape with the rest of the sword. So I think those are good to weld on at that position. So now that those things are all welded on, well, the pegs, thing I want to do now is do a full weld across the back here, and the same on the other side. Thank you. Okay. There we go.
Oh god, that tip's a disgrace. Although kind of wasteful,
this is the fastest way to find out how much of a leather strip you need. It's always, always, always more than you think. Okay, I'll see, can I unwrap this carefully and use this one on the little handles too.
Inches.
Eight and a half feet
by about 2 inches. I cut it down from 2 inches wide to 1.5 because I thought that the two would just be a little bit too wide looking. Hopefully the leather will be a little bit more stretchy than this guy. Let's see what length that is. Oh, 3.5 foot for safety. 3.5 foot by 3.5 foot by 1.5 for the little ones. Now, torturing myself. Seeing as the handle actually, it's very hard to tell. Maybe. I could maybe do it a little clink this way. The chances of that being enough are probably very low, but I don't want to overdo it. No, it still needs more. I guess I'll just keep doing that till it goes right. You always have to check and recheck because the heat's liable to do anything. That's the idea. Oh, it's not focusing properly. It's having trouble with the light, all the crazy angles refracting, but I don't know, can you see, but that there's the bump is gone. Or like the bump is smoother now. Nope, it's refracting too much. This is a relatively rough finish, so I'll go at it with the other ones, the smoother ones. But that's all the evidence of joinery gone. whole area was just my in-law's junk room, and I had to tidy it up. But every so often there'll be a piece of the old junk somewhere that I've forgotten about, and there was a cardboard box there. Was there even a box amongst all that smouldering stuff, or was it just a bunch of teapots and things wrapped up in newspapers? So yeah, worst possible thing to have when you're doing a bunch of grinding. But you can see the effect, you know, starting to appear. You know, obviously I'm just taking off the bulk of it with this and then going for the little one to get the final blend into the surface. And then I'll have to do something over this side too. But that's the idea, to create this raised ridge. Whew! Air in here still smoky. The light in here is terrible, but that's kind of the idea. Is there a different angle that the reflections are less severe from? Oh yeah, it looks more natural. Looks more what it actually looks like from this angle. So that's the idea. Is the teeth coming out of the... I'll have to get an iron file in there. I don't like that thing in there. Oh, the air in here is gross. See the, see the mat of little filings? It has a different quality than it does normally. I wonder when you use these mop disc things, it's not like raw sparks. There's more like sandpaper mixed in there. It's not bonding to itself the way it normally does. Like, see, there's some parts of it like this that are bonded, but like the, yeah, it's way less stuck to itself than it normally is. Oh. But that's all the teeth done on this side, at least. On this one side, I still have to do the inner ridge on this side over here. Oh, you see the difference. But oh, it's getting there. So I think for sharpening these guys, I might just round them off and I'll bring this guy down to a point. But I'm worried about making these too fragile. You know, like if they were sharpened as much on the littler ones, which are sitting over there, I sharpen them off very thin because it's a small thing and you can easily control it. But there's so much weight behind this monster that I'm worried that if it was like sharpened, sharp, like all the way down, like taper, like these things would be very fragile. So I might just sharpen them less than I sharpen the smaller ones comparatively. Like make them pointy, but not actually remove that much material other than the pointy bit at the end. Cause so much weight, so much weight. Oh, so what we did here was regular flap disc, followed by the coarse interleaf flap disc, followed by the fine interleaf flap disc. So it bit me again. I was grinding here. This is the next day, obviously, because I had a nice ER trip. I was grinding and I was trying to get in here And whatever dumb, stupid move I made, it grabs this, grabbed the disc, which, what did it do? But it somehow flipped around, and the grinder mushed my hand, but it mushed in here. It mushed in here against the edge of this tooth. And so I was like, I thought it was a broken disc that got me, but it wasn't a broken disc. The disc is fine. Some of my blood went into making this guy. You have to be very careful when you're grinding these like little wedge shapes, anything that might grab a disc. So I think I'm going to finish this curve off, just this inner curve, with files and sandpaper. See, I'd already done the other side here. See, the other side already was okay. Like, I still have all my fingers, but this side, yeah, it decided to bite me. This one, it's a very bitey type of sword. Is that done?
Yep.
Eben's getting the chain ready. The thing that holds the blade on, blah, 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 that little peg. He's cut the links and then bent them back into position so then I can TIG weld them. Do it again, need to.
So Eben over there is putting a very slight oxide layer on the surface of the blade, the smaller blades, like this. It's not the hope is, since it's only tickling the surface for a minute, it won't affect the temper too bad, but as you can see, we're not doing the teeth stay shiny, so even if it does affect the temper, it becomes more like a McQueetle, like where it has a soft body with the hardened steel teeth. And you have to be very careful when you're doing it, because you can't overdo it. You have to only tickle the surface just barely, just for a second, because you can heat the surface for like a second and get the blue color, and the hope is it saves gas and it also saves on damaging the temper of the steel too much. So that's the idea. Now, because this thing isn't heavy enough already, I'm going to be welding a chain, that big long chain I had. Hopefully, just wrap it around a couple of times, decorate this area.
actually very hard to fix a chain on like this, so it looks like it's just wrapped around haphazardly, but it's actually securely fixed. But there we go, it's done now. I should have clamped the sword! Whew. I should have waited to spray the chain with WD-40. The chain was looking kind of dusty and burnt. I just wanted to see with the WD-40, would it look darker? And as you can see, it does. You can almost do without the leather, but the small ones have leather, so I thought the big one should too. This is just me making sure the length is right. Then do the same thing, smear that glue all over it. Okay, so that is indeed long enough. Will my stitches pop when I try to lift this thing? Stay tuned to find out. Oh, I'm so tired. Still recording? Is the thing even still in shot? It is. Come on glue, do your thing. Where's my electrical tape? I might put a piece of electrical tape on this till it dries. Woo. Normally I don't like filming from this side because of the chicken coop, but the sun's in the wrong position. But I can't film later in the day because I have to go. I have stuff to do. So, originally, this clip was going to come first, and I was going to make a comment at the end about like, oh, who will I get to help me do it? They won't be back here till after dark. But I also think it's important to show that the sword stood up post shenanigans, you know? I mean, I guess it was only one pallet. But it was the dark, I couldn't see what I was doing. But because it's the teeth that do all the chewing, the actual oxide layer, I was worried that it might get scratched up. But it seems to survive pretty okay. You can swing the sword with the blade still attached. Actually, I might put it back on the tripod just to demonstrate taking it off. So in my head, I envisioned the boss holding this and then the two mini bosses coming and lifting the swords off, but obviously I can't do that by myself, not unless I was some six-armed god, and the old cybernetics aren't quite there yet, but that's the idea. Swords come on up. Hang on, I'll get some close-ups. Yeah, so this is after doing a bunch of smashing. Ah, it's the light, the sun from this side. So, post-smash. Do you like my new stump? Me and Evan went and got the new stump because the old stump, wherever that is, got really rotten. But, yeah. Whew. Cerberus. Normally I can blame the ridiculous design of these swords on the video game they come from. But because this sword is my design, all of the nonsense on show here is strictly my fault. It's my fault this one is so nutty. Closing shot from the correct side. Can I use my hand to see, shield the sun? I can. Run! Woo!
your mother!